Well, welcome back. Hope you guys had a happy Easter. We've been working on word problems, and I guess you guys have to focus on this side of the screen because it's broke again. You want to try pushing the on button on the thing? Okay. See if that works. But you guys can at least watch this screen over here. And we're talking about doing max min problems, a special type of problem. To optimization, this is like huge stuff here, okay? And to maximize or minimize, this is gonna haunt you throughout the rest of your science career when you want to figure out when exactly to do something rather, the optimal spot, your max min problems and stuff. But I tried to give you guys these steps last time and I wanna make sure you get them down because this is how you attack a max min problem. Step one, read problem, draw a picture, and label it. Step two, come up with the objective equation. Remember, in calculus, your objective is to take derivative of somebody. It's what you want to maximize or minimize. That's your objective equation. Step three, come up with the constraint equations. Constraint equations are the equations with the given information. Step four, solve the constraint equation for one of the variables and substitute it into the objective equation. And then clean it up. And therefore, you got your objective equation in terms of one variable. Step five, take derivative, set it equals zero and solve. But don't forget step number six. Because once you take derivative, set it equals zero and solve, you got your solution. But go back and answer the question. Don't forget to do step number six. All right. So let's take a look at the next problem we were doing last time. This is on section 4.7 here. All right, number two says this, find two numbers, A and B, with A less than or equal to B, whose difference is 42, whose product is to be minimized. Well, this is one I stole right off of WebWork. It's not overly difficult, but there's not really that much stuff I need to draw on this thing. But I do need to draw this. I gotta have two numbers, A and B, so I can at least draw A and B here. And I have this information with A less than or equal to B, whose difference, what does difference mean to you guys? Subtract. But, take a look at this, whose difference is 42. Now, A is less than or equal to B. So if I'm subtracting things, what do I typically want to subtract? Big minus small, so how should I subtract these guys? B minus A is equal to 42. And this is actually your constraint equation, because that's the equation for the given information. The difference is 42, but since they told me A is less than or equal to B, I need to subtract them B minus A. B minus A is 42. But here's the big deal. Whose product is to be minimized? Product means what to you guys? Multiply. So my product, I'll call them P for product, is equal to A times B, and this is the objective equation. This is the dude I want to take derivative of, set him equal to zero, and solve. But you'll notice here that too many variables. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go over to my constraint equation and solve for one of my variables. What's the easiest variable to solve for if I got B minus A equals 42? I'm going to solve for B by adding A to both sides. This gives me B is equal to 42 plus A. And I'm going to substitute it in for B over here. This is going to give me P for product equals A times 42 plus A. I'm going to distribute P is equal to 42A plus A squared. There it is, my objective equation in terms of one variable. That's the goal. So, what do I want to do? There you go. Now you do your classic calculus. To maximize or minimize, I want to take derivative of it, set it equals zero and solve. Derivative of 42a is 42, plus derivative a squared is 2a, set it equal to zero. That gives me 42 is equal to a negative 2a, divided by negative 2 on both sides. A is equal to negative 21. But don't forget your step number six. What I'm going to do, go back and read the question. What was my question again? Oh, yeah. I'm supposed to find two numbers, A and B, whose difference was 42, but whose product is to be minimized. Well, I got my A number, that's equal to negative 21. To get my B number, go back to the constraint. The constraint is your linking variable equation. B is equal to 42 plus A. So 42 plus A, which is 42 plus negative 21, is equal to a positive 21. So B equals 21. There are my two numbers. A is negative 21, B is positive 21. Now here's also the deal. I have some very bright individuals in this class, and I understand that. That's the purpose of why you're here in the first place. Not everybody can do what we can do. But I gotta show you the mathematics behind this stuff. Now I know a lot of you guys can actually could have figured out this problem. I gotta have two numbers whose difference is 42, whose product is gonna be minimized. Well, if one of them can be negative, the larger one of them is negative, the more minimum it's gonna get, because the larger the negative, the smaller it is, right? And some people could have gone, oh, well, that makes sense to me. It would have been like, I split right down the middle. 42 split down the middle is 21, make one of them positive 21, the other one negative 21, that's going to give me a minimum product. That's awesome, but there was no calculus in that theory whatsoever. Understand this is a calculus course. I want to see constraint equations and objective equations and manipulating the constraint inside of objective equation, cleaning up the objective equation, taking a derivative, setting them equal to your favorite number and solving for it. I want to see some calculus on this stuff. Just because you have the intellect to be able to come up with the answer, but if you didn't use any calculus, you don't get to see any points. Okay? Remember, it's calculus class. All right, turn page. Here's another classic problem here. A box to be made out of an 10 by 18 piece of cardboard. Squares of equal size are to be cut out each corner. With the ends of the sides, end and the sides, will be folded up to form a box with an open top. Find the length, the width, and the height of the resulting box that maximizes the volume of the box, assuming width is less than or equal to length. Again, stole off the Wilbur. Okay? So you understand what I've got here on this particular problem is I've got this box right here, or a piece of paper, that is 18, and I really meant to put 18 inches there, by 10 inches. So this will be the long way right here. So we'll say this is 18 inches by 10 inches, okay? And we are constructing this thing. So understand, so let me see if I can draw this thing out for you guys. You guys can see this. Let me blow it back down again so you guys can see this, what I'm doing. All right, here's a nice clean sheet of paper here. Got a nice piece of paper here. This is something when I was in school back in the 7th grade, we had to do in something called shop class. When I was in 7th grade, everybody had to take shop, home ec, music appreciation, and art appreciation. It was 9 weeks every class. So all the guys had to take home ec, all the girls had to take shop. We basically just rotated around throughout the year from art appreciation to music appreciation to shop to home ec. Well, while we're in shop, the shop teacher said we had to make some stuff. This is back in the good old days of not being politically correct. And what we had to do was we took this piece of tin. This thing was about 10 inches by 18 inch piece of tin. And we had to cut little squares out of the corners. Little tin snips. Okay? So there's a little X I may cut out of that thing. I'll make a little X here, X here. Come over here to this corner. Take my little tin snips and cut out an X right here. X here and X here. Come over here. I had to cut out a little corner here. And here, X here, X here. And over here, had to cut out a little corner. X here and X here. Okay? And what I did was take my little tin snips. I want to show you. Should have brought a pair of scissors, but there we go. I can just rip it out that way. Alright, so I pulled out my X by X corner there. X stage cut job there, but okay, there it is. So now I got this 10 by 18 inch piece of tin. Then I had to fold up the corners. That's what you're supposed to do. This is what the description in this problem is. You just fold up the sides. On this thing, just to give you an idea of what you're supposed to be doing. Then we would solder this corner here, solder this corner here, solder this corner here, and solder this corner right here. And then we would make this. What did I make? No. Gotta remember the days that I lived. We gave it to our parents and we're very proud of it. It's called an ashtray. They were very proud of this thing. They showed it to all their friends and their friends came over and took their ashes from their cigarettes and dumped it into this thing. Our goal is to make the biggest box possible, biggest ashtray possible, that our friends could put as many ashes into this ashtray as humanly possible. What do the dimensions have to be? There's your question. Welcome to the politically incorrect world that I grew up in. Make an ashtray here. Now, think about the mathematics behind what we had to do here. Now, I know this day and age, you guys aren't even allowed to have shop class because you can imagine a bunch of kids running around with a hot soldering iron doing this and sticking each other's legs and stuff like that, which is exactly what we did when I was in school. We just didn't cry about it and go tell the principal and have some kind of lawsuit or anything. We just said, man up and just stick the guy back with your soldering iron. It's all right. You can get him back. But this is what we did. We soldered. We actually played with things that can cut your fingers off. It was pretty radical back in the days. All right, but there it is. I want you guys to build a box. That's what this problem is all about. Now, look at how they describe it here. You got a box made out of a, because there's a lot of dimensional stuff here. You have to see this. There's a box made out of a 10-inch by 18-inch piece of cardboard. Squares are equal size to be cut out. So here's my putting my variables on this thing. You'll notice the amount we're cutting out, I called it X. Because they're squares, it's X by X. Okay, but here's the deal. When I folded up the sides, we made an open top box. Okay? And we want to do what? Maximize the volume. Get as much ashes in our big ashtray as humanly possible here. We want to maximize the volume of this thing. Well, you got to have the dimensions of the box. Now, here comes the math right here. What is the length, the width, and the height? Now, remember, because this is web work, width is less than or equal to the length. So I'm going to call this the longest side over here. This will be my length, this will be my width, and this is my height over here. But what are these dimensions? Now, here comes, so maximize volume. Volume is going to be length times width times height. But that's just got way too many variables to take root of. Does that make sense? So I need to somehow come up with the constraint equation. What's my constraint? I had a 10-inch by 18-inch piece of cardboard here. Okay? But if I had 10 inches, now you got to put it over here to dimension, and think about it. This thing is 10 inches long, right? And I cut out X here, and I cut out X here and folded it up. What is the dimension now? 10 minus 2x. That would have been my width, 10 minus 2x. This thing was the long side. That was 18 inches. 18 inches, but again, I flipped up one side and I flipped up the other, and because of that x I cut out of, what is the dimensions of the longest side? 18 minus 2x. Again, this is that visual stuff. Now, here comes the important one. If you take this piece of tin or a piece of cardboard and flip up the little sides around it to make this box, what is the height of the box? X. You've got to convert them back into the variables that you created. Does that make sense? So now, plugging this information in, there's my constraint plugged into the observation mathematics here. Volume is actually equal to length, which is 18 minus 2x, times width, which is 10 minus 2x, times height, which is x. What I want to do here is to take the derivative of it, set it equals 0, and solve. You got two ways you can do this. You can do the famous triple product rule. Are you familiar with the triple product rule? What's the product rule? Well, drew the first times second plus the first time drew the second. You do the triple product rule. Drew the first times the other two guys, plus drew the middle times the other two guys, times drew the other guy, last guy times the other two guys. Makes it a little bit long, but you can do it that way. Or you can do John's fundamental theorem of calculus, and that is clean it up first. If I was going to clean it up first, I'm going to FOIL out the 18 minus 2x times 10 minus 2x. Well, let's see here. 18 times 10, that's 180. 18 times 2x is plus 36x. What minus 2x times 10 is a minus 20x. And a minus 2x times a minus 2x is a plus 4x squared. All that times x. Oh, it should be. Thank you. Thank you. That's 18 times a minus 2x. That's right. It's a minus 36x. So when I combine like terms on that, that's going to be 180 minus minus 36x minus 26 minus 20x is minus what, 56x plus 4x squared times x. Does that make sense? Now I'm going to distribute the x throughout, and that's going to give me volume equals 180x minus 56x squared plus 44x cubed. Does that make sense? Now, how do you maximize, minimize anything? Take derivative, set equals zero, and solve. What's the derivative of 180x? 180. Minus what's the derivative of 56x squared? 112x, all right. Plus what's the derivative of 4x cubed? 12x squared. Set it equals zero and solve. And this is what's going to happen to you. You could probably factor a 2 out of this thing or something or other. That's fine. But the reality is it's a quadratic that's not going to factor for you. So this is 12x squared minus 112x plus 180 equals 0. And it doesn't factor. A quadratic that doesn't factor, you can still solve this thing. How am I going to solve it? What major formula do you know that solves quadratics? Quadratic formula. X equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. Plugging in, a is going to be equal to 12, b is going to be equal to a negative 112, and c equals 180, positive 180. Plugging that into my formula, watch your signs, I get negative, negative 112, plus or minus the square root of b, negative 112 quantity squared minus 4 times a, which is 12, times c, which is 180, all over 2 times 12. By the way, how many answers you gonna get on your calculator for this thing? It's plus or minus. So you're going to get two answers. Put this thing on your calculator, get the plus one, and then get the minus one. And then let me know which one you think the answer is going to be. Okay. I got two answers. I got 7.2700. It's WebWorks. Again, all the decimals. 83225. And I got 2.06325 0108. Take derivative, set equals zero and solve. Now when you get two answers, you can probably bank on the fact that one of these answers is going to maximize, one of them is going to minimize. But you also have to look at the constraints, and because sometimes a lot of these answers don't even make sense. X represents how much you're going to cut out of the corner, right? How big was your piece of paper or a piece of cardboard or a piece of tin, however you're looking at this problem? It was 10 inches by 18 inches, right? You should make a cut of 7.27 inches. Now let's think about that up here. If this is 7.27 inches, and this is 7.27 inches, And the whole thing is 18 inches, and this whole thing is 10 inches, that's even better. So you're taking 7.27 inches here and 7.27 inches here on a 10-inch piece of paper, you're imploding upon itself. You actually cut beyond what you have, right? In other words, this one doesn't make any sense. Now, mathematically, if you actually look at the graph, it minimizes it at some negative volume thing, but that's not real number math. Does that make sense? So, I mean, if you graph this thing, it actually does dip down below the x-axis type thing here. So, but what about the other one? 2.06 inches. That's what you should make, because that's the one that actually fits the model that you would get positive volume. Does that make sense? So the answer is 2.06 inches is what x should be. But always, I keep emphasizing this, go back and answer the question. The original question was, what should be the length, the width, and the height? Well, if you come back over here, remember the height was equal to x, the width was equal to 10 minus 2x, and the length was equal to 18 minus 2x. And the x number that we got was 2.06. So I'm just going to go out with decimals because this is web work. So 2.06350108. So, of course, the height would be 2.06350108 inches. Webwork doesn't care about units, but my test do. And 10 minus 2 times that 2.06 number there is 5.872997.84 inches. And 18 minus 2x is 13.872997.84 inches. So the dimensions that would maximize the amount of ashes, the volume of the box, is 2.035 by 5.87299 by 13.87299 inches. Does that make sense? But even though this did not quite fit the model of the format that I always put out, draw a picture, or they drew the picture, you still had to do some kind of labeling, and you had all this constraint. And the only constraint they really gave you was the 10 by 18 inch piece of paper. Okay? But you had to kind of fill in the dots on the volume is length times width times height, and then plugging in your numbers and stuff, and your formulas. Does that make sense? Now, and don't forget this, there's one other little trick I did here was they told me in the problem that width was less than length because based upon my constraints here, that made the width have to be 10 minus 2x and the length 18 minus 2x. So when I plug in x numbers, the length is actually bigger than the width. That will fit web work now. Does that make sense? I came up with this problem a couple years ago for my engineering students because, you know, key to most math and physics problems is pay attention to units. This is a problem that throws people fits all over the place. And but once you understand how to do it, you go, oh, that makes sense, but yeah, it's kind of lame that you have to do all this unit analysis stuff. Here it is. You got a cylindrical oatmeal container that has a capacity of 3 liters. Find the dimensions that will minimize the cost of production material to construct the container. This is a classic engineering problem. You guys seen the classic oatmeal containers, you know, Quaker oatmeal containers. It's basically a cylinder type thing here, and they got packed with 3 liters of oatmeal in this stuff. And I want to minimize construction of material, right? I want to minimize the cost of production material to construct a container. Well, it's a cylinder. So a cylinder has a height and has a radius. It also has having the same radius at the top there in case you want to know about it. Okay? How do you construct a cylinder? How do you make a cylinder? Well, what is the cylinder made of? Well, you've got a circle at the bottom, you've got a circle at the top, and you actually have a piece of paper that goes all the way around it, right? And if you think about constructing these guys, what you're really after is the SA, or surface area. The construction of something or other happens to deal with the material you're putting into it, or surface area. You with me? So what is the surface area of a cylinder? Well, you got two circles, that's two areas. What's the area of a circle is pi r squared, and you got two of them. Plus, the other thing you got is a rectangle, piece of paper. If you take your little Ginsu knife and slice this sucker right down the side here and unravel it, it's a piece of paper. It has a particular height, h, but it has a length based upon the circumference of the circle, which is 2 pi r. So the surface area of a cylinder is 2 pi r squared plus 2 pi r h. However, if you go back to the front of our little formula sheet here, and you go back and look at some of the formulas and stuff that we have with this stuff, you actually can go look up this particular formula on your formula sheet and stuff like that. Typically, we'd have given this thing to you, but this is our note, so you should have the ability to derive this in case absolutely necessary. But we would have given this formula to you. Problem is, too many variables. I got R's and H. I want to take rid of this guy, set him equals 0, and solve. But I also have the other, and here's the big deal, I have the other information. I have the constraint. The constraint information is the volume capacity is 3 liters. This is the objective equation right here. The surface area, because I want to minimize that. I want to take rid of that guy, set him equals 0, and solve. So my constraint is I have a cylinder that I just want to be able to have 3 liters of stuff inside of it. Here's your problem. What does liters measure? It measures volume, but what kind of volume? When you think of liters, what do you think of? Coke. Okay. And what is Coke? Coca-Cola. What is that? Liquid. Liquid volume is what liters measures, right? So they're talking about, that's not always the case though. It is also, you can do dry volume with liters as well, and they do that with oatmeal if you read the oatmeal container and stuff. So we're going to have to convert this thing over to dimensions that we can handle in terms of construction. Liters doesn't do well with construction. We want, I guess, milliliters, centimeters, or meters or something or other, right? We're going to convert it to metric because this is clearly a metric system here. But what is your conversion factor? Well, let's see what you guys know. 1 liter is actually equal to 1,000 what? Milliliters. Well, let's just talk about liquid for a second here. 1 liter is the same as 1,000 milliliters. Okay? But that's still in liters here. But the one other conversion factor that you need to know is this. Note, 1 milliliter is the same as 1 cc. You guys know what a cc is. Right. Even for my nursing majors and stuff like that, when they sit there and start doing syringes and things like that, it's usually measured either milliliters or cc's. It's the same thing. 1 milliliter is a cc, or, like you said, a cc is a 1 cubic centimeter, and that actually gets it back into the area that we would like it to be in. So 1 milliliter, since 1 milliliter is equal to 1 cc, that's equal to 1,000 centimeters cubed. 1 liter is 1,000 centimeters cubed. And so volume would be equal to, if I have 3 liters, I'm going to have what? 3,000 centimeters cubed. What is the volume of a cylinder? Volume of a cylinder is pi r squared h, and that is something you guys should definitely know. So putting these two guys together, I have my constraint equation. 3,000 is equal to pi r squared h. What do I do with my constraint? Check your steps out. I want to solve for one of the variables, and I want to plug it into the other one. Which variable do I want to solve for? I'm going to solve this thing for h, because I have multiple r's in this thing, but I only have one h. It would be easier to substitute back in for h. Solving is my answer for h. I get h is equal to, dividing, 3,000 over pi r squared. And now I'm going to take this, there's my linking equation, and plugging it back in for h, giving me my objective equation, surface area to be equal to 2 pi r squared plus 2 pi r times 3,000 over pi r squared. Slide it up here, you guys can see what I just did, plugged it in. But before I go take my derivative and win the game on this guy, I'm gonna clean them up. Let's see here, pi's cancel. One of the r's cancels there. So I get surface area equal to 2 pi r squared plus 2 times 3,000 is 6,000 over r. All I did was clean up my algebra. I got 2 pi r times 3,000 over pi r squared, and that r canceled with just one, leaving me still with a single r left over in the denominator. The pi's cancel. There we go. Now, I'm going to clean them up one more time because I'm going to take derivative of this guy. So this is 2 pi r squared plus 6,000 r to the negative 1. It's easier to take derivative of r to the negative 1 than it is 6,000 over r. Just trying to set it up for my derivative rules. So here I go. Take derivative. Derivative with respect to r here of 2 pi r squared would be 4 pi r. What's derivative of 6,000 r to the negative 1? Negative 6,000 r to the negative 2. Set it equal 0 and solve. I get 4 pi r is equal to 6,000 over r squared. What did I do there? I added 6,000 r to the negative 2 to both sides, but a negative exponent really goes back where? On the bottom and becomes positive. Now here's my move. I'm going to multiply both sides by r squared. Try not to skip a step here. Cancels on the left, gives me 4 pi r cubed is equal to 6,000. I'm going to divide by 4 pi on both sides. This gives me r cubed is equal to 6,000 over 4 pi. Didn't say the answer is going to work out well, but now here's the deal. What am I going to do to get rid of that cube? Take the cube root of both sides. And you're right, I'm going decimals on this thing. So I'm going to get r to be equal to, and I'll put it on my calculator here. Cube root, well, I do have a cube root button located under my math button, math number 4, there's cube root, but I'm not going to use him. I'm just going to put a parentheses around him. This will be 6,000 divided by parentheses around your denominator of 4 pi, close parentheses for the denominator, close parentheses there, raised to the cube root is also known as a what? 1/3 pi. What do I get? 7.81592641.8. And what would that be? Centimeters. It's a distance. That's what the radius should be if I want to maximize the volume. But go back and never forget this. Step number 6. Go back and answer the question. What was my question again? Find the dimensions that will minimize the cost of the production container. So the dimensions on this thing were r by h, so I need h. As h is equal to 3,000 over pi r squared, plugging in r is 7.8159, whatever here, I get 3,000 over pi times 7.81592641.8 squared. And putting that on my calculator, what do I get for H? I get this. 15.63185284 centimeters. This would be the dimensions that would yield the smallest amount of production material, minimized production material. Which is, you made, does that make sense though? And the reason why I threw this one at my classic engineering students is that idea of paying attention to units. You know, that 3,000, I mean, that 3 liters, that's great, but that's liquid volume. If I want to measure that stuff out, my tape measure doesn't do real well with liters. I have to sit there and do some conversion factoring over it. And the real deal was 1 milliliter is the same thing as 1 cc or centimeter cubed. So that was the easy conversion factor. Here's some more web work problems right here. So because of this, look at how I'm attacking them. These are web work problems. I went ahead and drew this one out for you, but usually they just give you this information here. Here it is. Find the dimensions of the rectangle of largest area that has its base on the x-axis and its other two vertices above the x-axis lying on the parabola y equals 4 minus x squared. So I went ahead and drew this thing out for you if you understand this problem. Here's the parabola. Y equals 4 minus x squared. There's the parabola right there. We made this little rectangle. And these points right here are ordered pairs, x, y, and this, I guess, would be negative x, y, if you think about going over x up y type thing here. Okay, these are just points. I can just call him just another x, y. But they're the same points, except the y's are the same. The x's want to be positive, want to be negative. That's all my thing. And we're talking about making this rectangle right here. And we want to largest area. Largest means maximize. Maximize area. Area of a rectangle is length times width. That's my objective equation. However, here's the deal. I got to put it in terms of the information I have here. I'm interested in getting the area of this particular spot. Here's the deal. Area is length times width. What is the width of this thing? What's that distance right there? Very good. How do you plot points? You go over x, up y. So the length happens to be y. Does that make sense? What is the width of this thing? Well, very good. If this is x, and this also has to be x because of symmetry, that makes your width equal to 2x. And you have to be able to outthink the problem. So when you clean it up, you get area equals 2x times y. Does that make sense? All right, there it is. There is your objective equation. You want to take the derivative of this guy, set him equal to 0 and solve, and what's the classic problem? It's too many variables. So go to constraint. This is about the easiest constraint equation I can give you. What's my constraint equation? You had to be on this parabola. What was that parabola? Y equals 4 minus x squared. I actually gave you the constraint equation. Y equals 4 minus x squared. So go and plug it in over here. X is going to give you area equals 2 times at y, which is 4 minus x squared. So area equals, when you clean this up, 2x times 4 minus x squared. When you distribute, you get, what is that, 8x minus 2x cubed. So now, take your derivative, set m equal to 0 and solve. Derivative of 8x is 8 minus derivative of 2x cubed is 6x squared. Set m equal to 0 and solve. 8 equals 6x squared by adding 6x squared to both sides. Divide by 6. It's 8, 6, same thing as 4 thirds. Equals x squared. X squared to both sides. X is equal to the square root of 4 thirds. officially plus or minus, but x is really this positive distance. So you're actually getting both of them. There's the positive square root of 4/3 and the negative square root of 4/3. But there's my answer. Officially it's plus or minus. So I'm just using the positive one. The square root of 4/3. You could clean them up and make them 2/3 if you wanted to. But here's the deal. Always go back. After you take derivative, set it equal to 0 and solve, go back and answer the question. What was my question? Find the dimensions of the rectangle. The rectangle is length by width, but if you remember, your length was y, your width was 2x, and you found what x is. So again, using decimals on your calculator type thing here, it's 2 times x, that'll be 2 times the square root of 4/3, because you typically widths and lengths are going to be positive here. So if you put that on the old calculator, you get this, 2 times the square root of 4/3. I get the width to be equal to 2.309401077. Does that make sense? That's the width, and what's the length going to be? The length is the y coordinate. But how do I get the y coordinate? Y is equal to what? 4 minus x squared. That's going to be 4 minus 2, that's going to be the square root, you can do this in your head, square root of 4/3 squared. What's the square root of 4/3 squared? Pretty much 4/3. This is 4 minus 4/3, and 4 minus 4/3 is 8/3. Or for you decimal lovers out there, 2.666666667. There you go. So the width was equal to 2.309. Get my decimals in the right spot. 2.309401077, and the length would be 2.666666667. There are my dimensions. Does that make sense? All right, keep practicing. Here's a similar problem, but this one's different. It's tying it back into stuff you guys did before. So I'm also always thinking, even though I got another 3 weeks of material to go through, I'm still going to be covering it until the last possible day here. I'm still reviewing for the final exam. Find the area of the largest rectangle that can be inscribed in the semicircle with radius 4. This is just like the problem we just did, except for one thing. That's not a parabola anymore. It's a circle. All right, it's a semicircle. But so, just like before, here's a point on your curve, which is x, y. Here's another point, pretty much negative x, y, if you think about it. So this was a distance x. This would also be a distance x. This is the distance y as you put it on this little block here. So the area of this block is length times width. This is the objective equation. Area is going to be equal to, well, the width is equal to 2x, just like before, and the length was equal to y. So pretty much your area is 2x times y, just like before, because of that symmetry, putting it right down the middle because of the y-axis. But now you've got to come up with the constraint. The constraint equations. What's my constraint? This box, this rectangle that you're talking about, has to be inside or inscribed inside of a semicircle, the circle of radius 4. Circle of radius 4, which you happen to notice is centered at the origin. It's centered at the origin. What is the equation of a circle centered at the origin? There it is, back to chapter 1 again. Remember that equation. Well, the equation of a circle centered at any point is x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared. But you're centering at the origin, 0, 0, there's your hk. So this is x minus 0 squared plus y minus 0 squared equals your radius, which is 4 squared. When you clean them up, that's x squared plus y squared equals 16. That you had to go back and review and remember. Now, it's a semicircle. What I really want to do is I want to come over here and substitute in for y my equation so I can get my objective equation in terms of one variable. I'm going to solve this for y. So subtract x squared from both sides. That gives you y squared equals 16 minus x squared. I take the square root of both sides, and officially plus or minus, but wait, it's not going to be plus or minus on this one because all I needed was a semicircle. When you do plus or minus on y, solving for y, the plus will be the top half of a circle, and the minus will be the bottom half of the circle. Which part of the circle will we be using for on this guy? We're using the top half. Because we're using the top half, I'm just going to use the positive square root. Does that make sense? And so it's officially plus or minus, but because we're just using the top half, all I need is the positive one. So substituting him in right in here, I get area is equal to 2 times y, but y is the square root of 16 minus x squared. Getting rid of, I don't do square roots, what's a square root? 1/2 power. And here becomes a little more interesting game. You need to take rid of this guy, set him to go to 0 and solve. Classic. Reinforcing your derivative laws. 2x times x 16 minus x squared to the half a power. What rule am I going to use? Product rule. Derivative the first time the second plus the first time derivative the second. What is derivative the first? What's derivative 2x? 2 derivative the first. Wait a minute. Times the second. 16 minus x squared to the half a power. Plus the first. 2x times the derivative the second. How do I take a derivative of this part, 16 minus x squared to the half a power, and what rule would I use on that part? Chain rule. Derivative the outside, inside stays the same time, derivative the inside. Derivative the outside, 1/2 pops out front. The inside stays the same, raised to the negative 1/2, times derivative the inside, which is a negative 2x. Product rule. Derivative the first times the second, plus the first times derivative the second, but take derivative the second, I use the chain rule. Derivative the outside, the inside stayed the same, raise the negative 1/2, subtract 1, times derivative the inside. Now clean him up. Be careful on this. This will be 2 times, I'm going to write him back in square root terms, just because we're going to have to solve this guy. That'll be 2 times the square root of 16 minus x squared. This 2 and that half will cancel the 2s. I am left with a negative 2x times another x, which makes it minus 2x squared. And where does a negative exponent put you? On the bottom, the denominator. And what is a half a power also known as? Square root on the bottom. Clean them up. That's the trick on this one. You must see the algebra on this one. Now, of course, back to maximizing or minimizing. I'm going to take my derivative, set it equal to 0, and solve. I'm going to move this to the other side. This gives me 2 times the square root of 16 minus x squared equals 2x squared over the square root of 16 minus x squared. I just moved this entire term by adding it to the other side. I'm trying to solve, and I got fractions. Next thing I want to do is I'm trying to solve for something rather than I got a bunch of fractions in my equation here. I'm going to multiply by my common, in this case, only denominator. What am I going to do? I'm going to multiply both sides by the square. square root of 16 minus x squared. Does that make sense? This side will cancel. But here's the deal. What is the square root of 16 minus x squared times the square root of 16 minus x squared? That 2's still out front, but the square roots cancel here. You get 16 minus x squared equals 2x squared. Because the square roots canceled here and got rid of the complete square root of 16 minus x squared altogether. Here, the square and the square root cancel with the square, you just get the 16 minus x squared. I'm going to distribute the 2. That's going to give me 32 minus 2x squared equals 2x squared. Add 2x squared to both sides. You get 32 is equal to 4x squared. Divide by 4. I get x squared is equal to, 32 divided by 4 is 8. As x squared equals 8, take the square root of both sides. X is going to be the square root of 8, or 2 square roots of 2, or whatever decimal version you want of that. And now go back and answer the question. They just want you to find the area. And ask for the dimensions on this one. Read the question. Find the area. Well, what's the area equal to? I can go back to this equation here because I got x. Square root of 8, basically. So what's this? Area A is equal to 2x times the square root of 16 minus x squared. This is my cleaned up version before I took this derivative. I'm going to replace x with square root of 8. So this is equal to 2 square roots of 8 times the square root of 16 minus the square root of 8 squared. Let's just do some math here. Square root of 8 squared, 8. 16 minus 8, 8. Square root of 8 times square root of 8 times 2. Answer 16. The area is going to be 16 units square. Does that make sense? All I did was, you could put on your calculator if you want to, but you didn't need to. Here's another Weber problem that I have a lot of folks screwed up on. I've gone through this material before you because of one thing, making the connection. Because this is all they give you in Weber prior. And it's about as easy as we can throw it at you, but you got to interpret, understand what things mean. Here it is. Find the point on the line y equals 4x plus 7, which is closest to the point 0, 0. Find the point on the line y equals 4x plus 7, which is closest to the point 0, 0. That's all I'm going to take. Now, people look at this and the first thing they do is they graph it. Okay, great. And go, okay. So 4x plus 7. Zoom 6. And they look at it and go, okay. Find the point which is closest to the point 0, 0. And graphing it, just to give you a visual, is not bad. Looks like this. Okay, your y-axis, SE 7 up here. Slope was 4, rise 4, run 1, something like that. So there's your line right there. Here's the point 0, 0. You want to find the point that's closest. I think it's right about there. Well, that's a good guess. That's a guess. That's not mathematics. Okay? So, what am I going to do? And here's the problem. Most folks don't know where to start with this one. They wrote it down, drew a picture, great, done, and label everything. They think it's this point right here, x, y. That's great. But here's the thing. You're missing your steps. Step one, read problem, draw a picture, okay, good. Label it, okay, there's my point, x, y, I think it's going to be my closest one right about there. Okay? Now, step two, come up with the objective equation. interpreting. We didn't tell you to minimize or maximize anything. We just said what's the closest point. What does the word closest mean to you? Minimum distance. That's the thing that people couldn't make that closest implies minimum distance. So which means you've got to have a distance formula. What's your distance formula? That's right, goes back to basic algebra one. What's the distance formula? Square root of x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. Got to know your formulas. So there it is. And there are two points. The point that I'm interested in is xy, and the other point was at the origin, 0, 0. So this would be d is equal to the square root of x minus 0 squared plus y minus 0 squared. X minus 0, y minus 0, plugged in there. So d equals the square root of x squared plus y squared. But wait, I got some more information. That's just the objective equation. There's a constraint here. What's my constraint equation? Y equals 4x plus 7. I'm going to replace that y with 4x plus 7 because I got to be on that line, y equals 4x plus 7. So d is equal to the square root of x squared plus 4x plus 7 squared. So there's my distance that we want to minimize, closest. Take derivative of it, set equals 0 and solve. But before you do that, may I make a suggestion? John's fundamental theorem of calculus. What's John's fundamental theorem of calculus? Clean up that algebra first. Before I take a derivative of something weird like that, I'm going to go ahead and clean it up as much as possible. I'm talking about inside this parentheses here, inside the radical. With the 4x plus 7 squared, I literally will fold this guy out. So this will be d equals the square root of that x squared plus 4x times 4x is 16x squared. 4x times 7 is, 28x? Another 7 times 4x is another 28x. Plus 7 times 7 is 49. First, outer, inner, last. I fold it out. Combining like terms, d equals the square root of x squared plus 16x squared. How many x squared do I got? 17x squared. 28 and 28, what's that? 56 plus 56x plus 49. And so before I take a derivative, I'm going to clean them up one more time. 17x squared plus 56x plus 49 raised to the 1/2 power. Now, take derivative, set it equals 0 and solve. What rule are you going to use? Chain rule. Drift the outside, inside, stay the same time, drift the inside. Drift the outside, 1/2 pops out front, the inside, 17x squared plus 56x plus 49 stays the same, raised to the what? Negative 1/2 times drift the inside. Let's see here, 17 times 2 is what, 34? 34x plus 56. Set them equal to 0 and solve. Clean them up, this will be 34x plus 56 divided by 2 times the square root of 17x squared plus 56x plus 49 equals 0. Now notice that 1/2, the 2's already on the bottom. That is a negative exponent. Negative exponents go on the bottom, so I put them down there with the 2, and a half a power is the square root. That's how I cleaned up. So I've got a fraction equal to 0. What am I going to do? To solve, when you have a fraction equal to 0, you multiply both sides by your denominator. Square root of 17x squared plus 56x plus 49 on both sides. 2 times the square root of 17x squared plus 56x plus 49. And over here on the left, they cancel. You're left with 34x plus 56 equals 0 times a bunch of stuff is still 0. Solving for x, I'm going to subtract 56 from both sides. I get 34x equals a negative 56. And then I'm going to divide. divide by 34 on both sides and reduce all fractions. X is equal to negative 56 divided by 34. And it reduces to negative 28 17ths. I'm sorry, I just made up the numbers here, so you know, web work will do the same to you guys. Negative 28 over 17. So I got X coordinate to be negative 28 over 17. But don't forget to go back and answer the question. The question is, find the point. That's what I'm trying to emphasize here. A point is an XY coordinate. How do I find the Y coordinate? I got X, that's negative 28 over 17. Remember the constraint was Y equals, what was it, 4X plus 7. So Y equals 4 times negative 28 over 17 plus 7. And what do you guys get? 7 over 17. And the last thing is this. Does it make sense? Go back and look at your picture. I said the point was right about there. Now, in terms of my numbers, yeah, I guess that's about right. But more importantly, what quadrant did I knew my answer had to be in? Had to be in the second quadrant. And if you notice, my answer, which is negative 28 over 17, comma 7 over 17, you know, and that negative 28 over 17 is negative 1.647. Yep, that's about where I anticipated it being at. Does that make sense? Now, let's take a look at these guys. Here we go. If 2,000 square centimeters of material is available to make a box with a square base and an open top, find the largest possible volume of the box. Okay, that is a classic question here. Okay, we have this. 2,000 square centimeters of material is going to make a box with a square base. You've got to label it, so I drew my box out for you. X by X, square base. So the height's got to be different. Call that Y. Okay. Open top. So I'll just do this and say open top. Okay. We're supposed to find the largest possible volume. In other words, we want to maximize volume. Volume is equal to length times width times height. That'll be X times Y or X squared Y. I want to take rid of this guy, say M equals zero and solve. Standard problem, tell me variables. So I needed my constraint. It gave me the constraint. Now this is what you have to worry about, is to interpret the constraint. I got 2,000 squared centimeters, centimeters squared, of material available to construct the box. What are they talking about here? Squared centimeters. What is that measuring? So, and because it's a three-dimensional surface, it's called what? Surface area. But this is not your traditional surface area, because you've got to create the surface of the surface area, because you've got a square base and an open, no material there, top. Right? Question.
We just divide the total material by 5, find the volume of one side. We got 5
sides of water. Nope. Let me explain why. Because this is your problem with that square base and that open top. That's going to skew it up quite a bit, because you have no material on that top thing, so that's going to free up some of the material that you have to put on the other sides to possibly make this thing bigger. Okay? So, no, because that, now you're right, if it was just a plain old regular box that had a top and square, you know, you could make some number, make it to a big, I mean, it's going to be a cube if you want to sit there and maximize that type thing. But once you do that open top thing to it, that's going to really mess it up, because that frees you up with some material to put elsewhere and also to get, therefore to create more volume into certain parts of it. But what would your surface area be? It's the area of the surfaces. Well, I have the base, which is x squared, area of the bottom, which is a square, x by x. Plus, I have this side, x by y, but I got four of them looking just like it. One, two, three, four. But I have no top. So the surface area is going to be x squared plus 4xy. And that's your 2,000. 2,000 is equal to x squared plus 4xy. The purpose of the constraint equation is to solve for one of the variables. What is the easiest variable to solve for on this thing? Solve for y. I'm going to subtract x squared from both sides. That's going to give me 2,000 minus x squared equals 4xy. Now what you're going to do? Divide by 4x. But remember, I'm trying to clean this thing up because I'm going to eventually have to take its weird derivative thing here after I plug it in. So here's the thing. Divide by 4x, and what I do to one side, I do the other. But since I have multiple terms here, I'm going to divide each term by 4x. Instead of putting over one big 4x, put it under each term and clean them up because you are going to have to substitute this dude in. So that gives me y is equal to 2,000 divided by 4x. Well, 2,000 divided by 4 is how much? 500 over x minus x squared divided by x is just x over 4. So there's my guy, and I'm going to go plug him in over here. That's going to give me volume equals x squared times 500 over x minus x over 4. But before I take derivative set equals here and solve, I want to distribute. So volume is equal to, now clean this guy up, x goes next, I'm going to distribute here, that's going to give me officially 500x squared over x minus x squared times x over 4. But I want to clean them up, so I want you to see where this stuff came from. So volume equals x squared divided by x is just x, so that's 500 times x. X squared times x is x cubed with a 4 on the bottom makes it minus 1/4 x cubed. And again, I wrote them like that because I'm pulling out constants because I'm setting myself up to take the derivative. Does this make sense? So now, let's take derivative. Take derivative, set it equals 0 and solve. What's the root of 500x? Minus, what is derivative of 1/4 x cubed? No, no chain rule. Well, 1/4 is a constant. Leave them alone. What's the root of x cubed? Clean up your constants. So this is equal to 500 minus 3/4 x squared. Set them equal to 0 and solve. I'm going to add 3/4 x squared to both sides. So that gives me 500 equals 3/4 x squared. Solving for x. Personally, I would multiply by 4 to get rid of my fractions. I'm back to 2,000 equals 3x squared because the 4s will cancel. Dividing it by 3, that doesn't work nicely. So that's 2,000 over 3 equals x squared. And now what am I going to do to solve for x? And officially plus or minus, but x does represent a distance of box. So I don't really want the negative on this thing because it's a distance. So I'm just using the positive square root. So I get x equals the positive square root of 2,000 over 3. And for you decimal lovers that have to build this thing, let's see here. Square root of 2,000 divided by 3 is, you've got it, 25.81988897. And this would have been a centimeter, because that would be a distance. But then, of course, always go back and reread and answer their questions. Okay, we want to find the what? What was my question here? We wanted just to find the largest possible volume. So all they cared about, they didn't say find the dimensions or anything. They told me to find the volume. So now that I have my x, this is the last hoop to jump through, what am I going to do with it? Well, I want to plug it back into my volume equation, which was cleaned up right here. As volume was equal to 500x minus 1/4 x cubed, that was my volume equation, and based upon x. Remember, I got x. Remember, I also have, you know, x squared times y, but then I got to go back and figure out what y is. And if they ask me what the dimensions were, then yeah, I would do that, but I don't care about knowing what y is. I'm just going to go to the cleaned up version of volume and plug in x right here. Of 25.819888897, so I'm going to get volume equals. I'm going to show you guys a little trick on this thing. This is how I do it quickly on my calculator. See that number? That was my answer, right? I want to plug it into this equation. I got this little button called ANS. You guys were familiar with him? That's the previous answer in the memory of the calculator. It's right above your net negative sign here. So I'm going to type in 500 times ANS, that's my x, minus, parentheses around fractions, 1/4, times another parenthesis, another ANS for x, and I'm going to cube it. Does that make sense? And every time it sees answer, it's going to plug in 25.819888897. And what do I get for my volume? 8,606.629658 watt would my units be? Outstanding. Centimeters cubed. That's what they asked for. Does that make sense? All right. There's a few more on this problem, but I'm telling you, I can sit there and do these problems all day long, okay? So, these last two problems, I'm going to want you guys to do, and I want them due on Wednesday to me, because I'm going to actually go ahead and write it up for you guys, a solution, and we're going to compare our answers, okay? But here's the deal. On this one, are you guys familiar with a Norman window? You know what that is? It's a fancy window, but it actually goes back to the Middle Ages, back in England, when they used to make windows in buildings. But they made buildings out of stone. Making a window in a stone building is pretty tough. And they came up with this theory that if they, you know, rounded it off up there and put, you know, stone up here, because of the roundness, the weight would disperse to the sides instead of straight down, and you could actually make windows. So if you go over to England and look at some of those middle-aged homes and stuff, their windows aren't just rectangles. They have this arch to them, and it's all about basically loads and how much stone on top could be forced down to the sides and stuff. But a Norman window basically is this. You've got a regular window, where this would be called X, this is Y, but on top of it, you got a semicircle, okay? So this is the radius of a semicircle right here, but remember, the radius is equal to half X, okay? Now, Norman windows are very popular if you, like, live in places like at the beach, or more importantly, like in the mountains, where you want that beautiful view, because it will really open up your side of your house type thing here with this stuff. And so you're constructing a big old house out there in the mountains, you know, with multi-million dollar jobs here. And the perimeter around this Norman window is 45 feet. The perimeter is the distance all the way around. Your mission here is to maximize the area, largest possible area. But what is it? Remember, the area is the rectangle, so the area is equal to x times y, plus is the area of a semicircle. What's the area of a semicircle? 1/2 pi r squared. But remember, your radius is equal to 1/2 x because of the way it's constructed and stuff. So you can plug that in here. You want to take the root of this guy, set him equal to 0, and solve. But you got to put your perimeter on there. What about your perimeter? The perimeter, you're going y plus an x plus another y plus around a semicircle. What do you call it when you go around a circle? Circumference. What do you call it when you're going around a semicircle? Half circumference. half, what's your circumference of a circle? Circumference of a circle is pi, 2 pi r, but you're going to take half of that, which is where your pi r comes from. Okay, and remember, your radius is half x. So here's your perimeter, which is 45, and no, try to figure this one out. And also, do this problem here about the trap problem, too. We're always to try to set it up, and we'll talk about that next time. One last thing, though. If you look at your syllabus, this was a big section. I spent some time on this stuff. We've got one more section, which I'm covering on Wednesday. Homework's due on Friday when I make it up, so look for homework being posted. And you got a test on. All right, study hard. See you guys then.